Okay, hi everyone. I think we can start. So I'm going to talk about more technical details, how you submit data to Ismara, how different functions works, and also go live over some web pages so you see how interface works. What I'm going to talk about is Ismara genomes and data type support, then what steps you should take in order to prepare your data for upload, then show the uploading interface, go over web pages, show the averaging functionality and averaging the batch effect correction, and also talk about alternative ways to upload your data to the Ismara server, either with Ismara uploader or with Ismara client, and finally, overview of expert model. So as Eric already mentioned, we have support for five organisms right now. So this is human, mouse, yeast, rat, and E. coli. And here some statistic about genome version and how many genes, transcripts, motifs, transcription factors, microRNAs are included in every organism annotation. So also for human and mouse, we have support for all the genome versions like AG18 and MM9, but these are also based on old transcript annotation and old motif annotation. So here is actually what data types Ismara support. First of all, we can analyze microarray data. So we have support for Affymetrix chips. Data supposed to be in cell format from Affymetrix, and these chips are supported for human, mouse, rat, yeast, and E. coli. And we also support next generation sequencing data, so which could be either mapped reads in BAM or BED formats, or unmapped reads in FASTQ format. So FASTQ is supported for human, mouse, rat, and E. coli, and not supported for yeast. So here's a summary of how we process microarray data. So we do correction for background and unspecified binding using bioconductor packages like oligo, GCRMA, and so on. Then we filter out non-expressed probes, quantile normalize the data between the samples, and finish it with log transformation. For raw read data like in FASTQ format, we apply different strategies for RNA-seq and ChIP-seq. So if for RNA-seq, we map reads with Callisto algorithm to transcriptome, like Eric has shown before. For ChIP-seq, we map reads with Callisto algorithm to promoter regions. So ChIP-seq data is always mapped to the predefined regions. We do not infer genome-wide binding peaks for ChIP-seq. So for RNA-seq, we count reads per transcript, calculate TPM values for every transcript, and then log transform the data and use this in Ismara. While for ChIP-seq, we count reads and then use these counts in order to infer the dynamics of read density changes between promoter regions. So in case of mapped reads, of course, we take existing mapping, again, calculate TPM values or calculate read counts, and basically, yeah, then follow the same protocol as for raw read data. So one important thing here is that we usually strongly recommend users to support to submit raw reads instead of mapped data sets. Why is that? Just from our experience, sometimes we see that mapped data cause different problems. So for example, it could be mapped to a very different reference genome. It could be pre-processed in some different ways, which also lead to the problems when we try to calculate, for example, TPMs per transcript. So if possible, just upload the raw data. So as I already said, we support the following file formats like cell, BAM, BED, and FASTQ. And for FASTQ, it's also important to have a proper file extension in VAN. So I will tell about this a little bit later, talking about paired end support. Also, files could be compressed in with zip, it could be tarred, it could be zipped, or it could be submitted as archive of tar.gz. So also, it's quite important for good representation of results to properly name the sample files, because IsMara take the file names as sample names. And here is example of bad naming and good naming. So I will go about this on the next slide. But first about the compressing the files. So it's always a good idea to compress a file before uploading this. And this could be applied to cell, bed, and FASTQ. These files will be efficiently compressed. And this way you can significantly reduce the upload time. Upload time is crucial in some cases because some users have unstable network connection, and less time you spend for uploading your file, less is the probability that something goes wrong. So for BAM files, compression is not necessary because they're already compressed. And there is also no benefits if you compress all your files into one big archive, unless it's already exist in such form. In this case, of course, you can upload the whole archive. IsMara will automatically extract all the content and properly process it. So about file naming. So here I present two examples. So it's basically kind of the same data, the same profile, but we see in one case files were named in some comprehensive way, saying that this is, for example, day zero, this is day three, and yeah, when giving some information about replicates, and they automatically, in alphabetical order, they are arranged on these profiles in the way which is absolutely clear from the very beginning. So you can see the dynamics of from day zero, activity rise to the day three. In case if files were submitted with some identifiers which were given to these files, for example, by some sequencing centers, you can get something like what you see on the right plot. And you will need to spend some time in order to disentangle what it exactly means. So for example, here, the day zero samples are split. And in order to identify that for day zero, all activities are down. Yeah, you need to spend some time in order to remember that this identifier correspond to the day zero and this one too, and so on. So if possible, try to rename your samples because this is how they will be presented in the results. So the basic rule is actually name it in such way that if you list the directory, so in directory listing, the samples are just ordered the way you like to see it in the results. So here again, some example of good and bad naming. So on the left, we see the good example. So there is a comprehensive sample names, which will be automatically ordered properly on all the plots. And on the right, there is a bad example where we have identifiers from database, and in order to properly understand the results, you first need to make some kind of reference yourself to assign every identifier to the proper condition. So finally, in order to enforce the file order, you can use a special prefixes. So here is example, and it's also important for such prefixes to use zeros at the beginning, for example, because in alphanumerical sort, if you just put 1 instead of 0, 1, this sample will be listed actually after the samples which starts with 1. So this is shown in the examples. Now about file naming for paired and FASTQ files. So paired and FASTQ files require a special suffix at the end of file name. So it should be underscore R1 for one end and underscore R2 for another end. So sample names for both files will be the same before the prefix. So here is example. So I have two samples, so this is control one, and I have one file with first end and then another file with a second end. So unfortunately, ISMARA doesn't support yet multiple files pairs per sample. So yeah, you have to merge these files before the submission. If you need assistance with that, yeah, you are welcome. We can always give you a consultation how to do this on different platforms. Okay, so now about the dataset upload. So first of all, about the parameters which you see on this page. So we actually always try to keep our tools as simple as possible and to force user to choose as less parameters as possible to make the simplest use of the tools. So in this case, basically you have, first of all, email and project name. These are optional fields, so you can submit your data anonymously without any email, but I would recommend that you always specify your email. Why? So first of all, if you specify email, after job is finished, you will get a notification with a link to results. And so you can easily access it and download if necessary and so on. Also in case if there is a problem in processing of the data, from the, and if you submit email address, we can always contact you if something went wrong, also to find way to resolve the problem, to find the best solution. So if you submit data anonymously, of course, if something is broken, yeah, you have to contact yourself. So yeah, because you don't know a contact person. Project name. Project name could be also quite useful because when you open results, it is shown on the top left. And if you have results, let's say from multiple data sets, you want to compare and you start to switch between the browser tabs to have some identificator of the data set could be quite important. So you can easily distinguish between the different data sets. Also, in case of problems for us, it will be quite easy to find the data set just by the project name if you submitted it with a project name. So next is a data type. So for data type, yeah, you see we support microarray, RNA-seq, and ChIP-seq. So in case of microarray, the only additional option you can choose is if you would like to run it with microRNA included or without microRNAs. Here is a email, here is a project name, and here is options for data type. So for microarray, as I said, you don't need to choose anything else, just specify microarray data type. But in case of RNA-seq or ChIP-seq, you also have to choose the corresponding organism, because usually we couldn't extract information about which genome, which organism, which genome version was used, for example, for mapping to which organism FASTQ dataset belongs. So you have to you always have to specify which organism it's coming from. So it could be either human, mouse, rat, E. coli, and we also have to older versions of genome, but these older versions works only with mapped data. So for these two versions of human and mouse genomes, we don't have support for FASTQ files. Okay, so let's say I would like to submit data FASTQ files, RNA-seq for okay, let's choose mouse. And now I would like to add some files. So here I have some example data. So you see they are named like, by days, like in mouse liver data set. So you can, I can select them all at once. Open. And now you see the list of files shown here. Once you finished with adding files, so you can also edit one by one, files could be located anywhere on the disk, so in different directories. So once you finished, you just click start upload. And then, yeah, data start to upload. So here you can also see progress. And yeah. And basically there is also progress bar for every individual file. Once upload is finished, you automatically redirected to a so-called status page. So it shows you information about the job status. So either it's running or it could be some messages about errors which happened during the execution. This URL here is very important. So in case if you haven't provided your email address, you need to either keep this tab open until the job is finished or save this URL somewhere to access it later on. So this page is reloaded, I think, every 3 or 5 minutes. And once computation is finished, you will see here actually your results page, like this one here. So in case if you in case you haven't submitted your email address along with your data set, please don't forget either to keep this tab open all the time or to save this URL somewhere in order to access your results. All right. So about running time, so ISMARA usually runs from 1 hour to a few hours, depending on the size of data set, but it could be also sometimes longer in case if computational cluster is overloaded. So I would say to set threshold at 20, if you don't get any notification in 24 hours, then please contact us so we will find out if something went wrong. And if you contact us, it will be good if you provide us with a status page URL or, for example, project name, so we can quickly locate your job on the server and check if everything is okay. Okay, so now I'm going through some results page. So as Eric already introduced, so that will be developmental dynamics of the mouse liver transcriptome. So here is the link to original data set. You can download data and try it yourself. And so there are 12 time points, I think 2 replicates per time point, and they are separated in different phases like prenatal, postnatal. Postnatal is separated to suckling phase and postweaning phase. And now, okay. And here example of the main page. So I switch back to browser. Before I move to the mouse liver data set, few words about tabs here in the main interface. So we have an example results section, which lists different ISMARA runs for different data sets. So it includes usually the data set itself, plus some averaging results. So for example, for Illumina body map, so we have average over replicates, average over young and old. For GNF SIM Atlas, so there is averaging cancer versus non-cancers, and so on. And so on the bottom, we have links to this mouse liver data set. So we have not averaged, and we have also average version of the results. So you can click and open this. So other tabs include some general information, information about usage, supported affymetrix chips for different organisms. Also, it includes some data which you can download, then upload again, run and see how it compares with a predefined set of results. And here is how you can upload data to the server. Here I would like to point you to this ISMARA client and ISMARA uploader. I will review it later, but these days when people work from home, sometimes not with very good internet connection, use of these utilities, ISMARA client and ISMARA uploader, will be quite important and can make data uploading to ISMARA web server much, much easier. So when there is a frequently asked questions section, example results, and yeah, terms of use and content. Okay, let's go back to the mouse liver data set. So as Eric already said, first of all, what you see on results page is a table of motif activities which are sorted by Z value here. So this Z value is actually average squares of Z values over all samples. So these Z values are all positive and they express a general significance of a particular motif in this analysis. So in this case, so the top one are E2F2, another E2F2 transcription factors. In this case, we are going down, indicating that cell division is reducing in postnatal phase. And I would like actually to show you results for HNF4 alpha. But before we go to the results page, so some demonstration of possibilities you can obtain on this page. So first of all, this table is sortable. So you can sort it by Z value, for example, to see what the highest and the lowest one. You can sort it also by motif name if necessary. But I think what is the most useful, you can actually search here for motifs. So if I search for HNF, so you see we have motifs associated with different HNF genes. So, and they're all listed here. So HNF4G and HNF4A. So I again can sort it. Now for every motif, we can actually, so we have a set of links. So you can access different databases to see information about this gene. So for example, you can go to Ensemble. Or you can go to NCBI, to MGI, or to UniProt. So then there is a profile picture. If you click on this, you can access the big picture of a profile. And there is also a logo of the motif itself, so which you can also click. Okay, let me open this in another tab. And so you can access the big picture of weight matrix. Now, I think actually I would like also to say, so as Eric mentioned, we group some motifs because we cannot statistically distinguish the activity between each other. So these motifs are grouped. And for such grouped motifs, for this one, or for example, even for this one, we show here only one logo. Some people think that this logo is represent motif, which is the same for both transcription factors in this case. That's not true. So we show here only one logo, one of the motifs which is included into this group motif, just because we don't have so much space in the table, and if we include all the logos, it will look awful. So, but if you click on the motif name, so you can see actually here we list motif logos for all motifs which are associated with all genes inside this grouped motif. So you see we have a separate motif for E2FF2, and we have separate motif for E2F5. All right, so now in addition to the motif page, we also have to motif table, we also have a sample table. Let me go down here. Here is the sample table. It's it just lists the names of samples in your data set. And this table is also used for specifying sample selection for averaging, if necessary. Or in case if you'd like to make a batch correction, also for specification of batches in your data set. So sample names are actually links to sample page, which I will also review a little bit later. A few words about the navigation menu on the left. So here in page navigation, so this is a motif significance table, sample table. Then there is a link to the page of mean activities, and also to the page which has a list of all promoters which are sorted by a fraction of explained variance. This we will also check later. Then there are special utilities, so you can search a gene if you like. So for example, E2F, and then you can see some information about this gene. This I will also show later what exactly it means. Button to start the averaging procedure. And then there is a download section, so you can download different data, activity table, delta table, list of regulatory interactions, motifs sorted by significance, which is basically just the main table you see on the screen. And also you can download the whole report in TAR-GZ format. So let's go now to HNF for alpha page. So on the top, you see the picture of which represents weight matrix. So this picture is clickable, so you can open this to get access to the picture of the motif. Then there is some information about the gene which is associated with this motif. So it's a name, its corresponding gene ID. So our gene annotation is based on ensemble, so we have corresponding ensemble ID. And if available, we have some information about the gene. So again, here are the links for this gene to a different databases if you need additional information. Next is activity expression correlation. So here you see again the gene name, the promoter which is associated with gene, and corresponding Pearson correlation coefficient. Also we provide a p-value, and there is a link. So if you just move your mouse to it, you can see a small version of the plot, but you can click it and see a big version of this plot. So as Eric already mentioned, these plots are quite important. They provide a lot of information. They show if expression of transcription factor correlates with its activity, which can indicate if a transcription factor is activator or repressor. But the lack of correlation doesn't indicate that something wrong. It could happen that there are different mechanisms of post-transcriptional activation. So for example, HNF4-alpha has been shown to change its activity upon phosphorylation and acetylation. So transcription factor could be expressed protein could be produced, but it was just not active because of missing phosphorylation or acetylation or something else. So next we have activity profile of HNF4 alpha motif. And so this picture, so you see, unfortunately, in case if we have very long sample names, so they wouldn't fit to the picture. But in this case, it's kind of interactive plot. So if you move mouse over the points, you can see, first of all, on the bottom, you can see the name of the sample. And on the top, it actually shows you the value of this point with corresponding error. In order, if you would like to save this picture, there is a special button on the top. So you can download this plot as image. And in addition, yeah, you can zoom, you can use these buttons for zooming, and you can rescale it back if necessary. So the next one is a picture of sorted Z values, which basically indicate in which sample we have the highest Z value, which usually correspond to the highest activity. So in this case, we see that the lowest activity and the less, so the most negative Z value correspond to the first time points in utero phase, and the most active points correspond to the the highest Z value, which correspond to the highest activity, they correspond to the last time points, which correspond basically to adult mice already. So the next is the string database. So Eric has reviewed it already. So we show the picture, but this picture is clickable. So if you click on this, it will direct you to the string database. So you can see this picture here. And now you have possibility actually to click on different proteins to get some information about this. So for example, here this cluster of CYP genes. You can also get information about connections between different proteins to see what evidence about what evidence support this connection. And in addition, String, of course, provide additional tools which you can find interesting. So for example, clustering, analysis, you can export this and so on. Then we have a first level regulatory network picture. As Eric said, this picture is interactive in a sense that, okay, first of all, you can get information. So if you move your mouse over the motif name, it shows you the corresponding Z value. And you see the motif of interest, in this case, HNF4 alpha, is in the center. The one in the center is always red. It just indicates that this is a central one. And all other motifs surrounding this are in blue. Now, if we have evidence that central motif regulate, central transcription factor regulate another transcription factor, we have arrow in the red. If we have evidence that blue transcription factor regulates the red one, we have arrow in the blue. So in case if they regulate each other, like for example here or here, we have actually two overlapping arrows. The intensity of color of arrow indicate the chi-square score. In this case, so we see that chi-square score of promoter, which correspond to NR5A2 gene, is 11.2. Now, we have a slider on the left with which you can actually remove the links and transcription factors which have the lowest chi-square score, so we can go down. And this way we just leave the most significant regulatory interactions. So in this case, so I just move here, so I now have four genes which are indicated to be regulated by HNF4-alpha, and three of them are well known. So HNF1-beta is known to regulate HNF4-alpha and vice versa. And it's also known that these nuclear receptors are also regulated by HNF4-alpha. But this picture actually can provide you some interesting candidates for future investigation. So it indicates that HNF4-alpha regulates promoters of genes EZR-B. Actually, we can see exactly. So it regulates promoter of EZR-A. And in the literature, I haven't found any experiments which prove it. So potentially, this is an interesting candidate for investigation about regulation of EZR-A by HNF4-alpha. So you can also access interactive SVG image, so which provide basically the same functionality, or you can download these images in PNG format. Now the target table. So this table, like almost all tables which present in ASMARA, provide you some interactive functionality. So for example, you can search gene names in here or gene ID. So if I type SIP here, it shows me that there is 18 cytochrome per 450 genes which are regulated by the HNF4-alpha. So what is important in this table is that it doesn't show you all the targets. Sometimes the target list could be quite long. So in order to make pages compact and easy to download, we decided to limit number of targets which are shown in this table only to top 200 entries. So if you need the full list of targets with corresponding scores, then you need to download the file which is given here as regulatory interaction. So it contains a list of all targets with corresponding scores. So also it should be mentioned in this page. So here we have a link to the promoter, so you can click it. It takes you to the Swiss Regulon database, and you can browse the promoter region to see what transcription factors are predicted to have binding sites in this promoter, also to see which transcripts and genes are around it. So you can zoom in, zoom out. So in this case, yeah, this promoter corresponds to these two transcripts of CYP2C29 gene. All right. Next, we provide information about gene overrepresentation in different categories. So these are also listed in the table. So you see here we have term ID, and here we have description of the term. And now we have a total log likelihood and log likelihood per target. What is this? So you see in this targets table, we for every promoter, we have a score. So what we do in order to calculate this overrepresentation, we just take a category and sum these target score in every category. And then the sum is shown as total log likelihood score, and the average, so the total divided by number of genes in the category, is shown as log likelihood per target. So we found that both of these metrics are useful because usually genes with highest total log likelihood, they correspond to rather general gene categories. So like in this case, it correspond to X progenase P450 pathway, which is not surprising taking into account how many cytochrome genes we've seen in the target list. And log likelihood per target or average log likelihood usually correspond to the most specific category. So you can see which categories are most specific for this target set. So in this case, this is sodium independent isoconoid transport and so on. So we provide this information about for biological process category, cellular components category, molecular function category, so which are standard for gene ontology collection. And in addition, we also provide two categories from molecular signature database. So these are two sets from curated gene sets categories. So this is canonical pathway and reactome pathway category. So, and in this case for HNF4-alpha, basically we see categories on the top which do make sense for HNF4-alpha. So for example, FOXR2 and FOXR3 are known to be regulated by HNF, as I remember correctly. So the top one in reactome category is organic cation transport. So this correspond actually to another big set of genes in target. So this is SLC, which are responsible for transport. So you see we have 12 of these in the top 200 targets. And basically, that's all about motif page. So the next one, I wanted to show actually one interesting example which we have here. So you see on the top, we also have quite interesting factor which is called UNR2E1. This is a nuclear receptor. And what is interesting about this, it shows quite an unusual activity profile. So if most of activity profiles here go rather monotonic from left to right or from right to left, this one has a plateau at early days and basically start to rise only at weaning stage of mouse development. So it was quite interesting. So we started to investigate what is known about this transcription factor. And for our surprise, we haven't found any information. When we had a closer look at this, so here is actually how useful is this activity expression plot. If we look at this activity expression plot, so first of all, it has basically zero correlation between expression and activity of this transcription factor. As I said, it doesn't mean that this factor doesn't work. It just says that there is no direct dependency between expression and activity. But if we look now at the expression range of this transcription factor, we see extremely low values. And it means that this transcription factor is actually not expressed along the whole time course. And so what happens here, we believe that most probably this motif for this transcription factor, so these targets are selected because they have a binding site for NR2E1, but in fact, they are regulated by a different transcription factor for which we have no information in our annotation and which is co-occurring with binding sites of NR2E1. But unfortunately, we have no idea what could it be. Another possibility, of course, is that this motif was wrongly assigned to these transcription factor, and in fact, there is a different transcription factors which binds to the binding sites of this motif and drive the expression changes of the targets. So this I wanted just to show as an example when you should be careful when you check your results. So pay attention to the expression levels, which could be quite informative from this plot. All right. And now also a little example here with E2F. So E2F2, as I said, so there are two different motifs. They have a little bit different transcription factor binding sites prediction. And in this expression correlation table, we have actually expression correlation for E2F2, and we have expression correlation for E2FF5. And here, the high correlation for E2F2 over lower correlation of E2F5 might indicate that, in fact, the targets here are indicated, are regulated by E2F2, not by E2FF5. Moreover, yeah, you can see that E2FF5 demonstrate a much lower variation of expression along the samples, while expression of E2FF2, you see, changes quite a lot from -2 to how much, to 8. So in this case, I think we can, with high confidence, assume that E2F2 is active and expressed in this experimental system. All right, so now I would like to move to another data set. So let's go back to the presentation. Yes, so for next steps, I would like actually to introduce the Illumina Body Map 2 project. It's also available from the example results page. So this data set consists of 16 RNA-seq samples from different tissues, human tissues. So for every tissue, there are two replicates. And yeah, here you can see actually the names of these tissues. So they are quite different, all over organisms. So we have a brain, we have liver, we have muscles, we have also adipose tissue and so on. And now I move back to the browser and go to example results and open Illumina Body Map dataset. So what I wanted to show here is actually that ISMARA could be applied not only to time courses, because sometimes people see the presentation with mouse liver dataset and they start to think somehow that ISMARA only applicable for time courses. No, it's applicable basically to any samples which demonstrate expression changes. So in this case, we apply ISMARA to the different tissues. And here are different activity profiles for different transcription factors. So let's have a look at, again, at HNF factor. So you see, it just shows that activity of HNF factor is pretty low, almost all tissues, except for kidney, and not surprising, highest it's in the liver. So basically, if you upload data set which contains different tissues or it contains different conditions, ISMARA will try to infer the transcription, so motifs of transcription factors, which are most indicate, so which are best explain the difference in expression between these samples. So it's applicable not only time courses, it's applicable basically to any experimental system. So if we look now at, for example, at this one, so MEF2D and MEF2A, MEF are genes which are known to be involved in regulation in muscle tissue. So if we open this picture, so you see very well that the highest activity correspond to the heart, to skeletal muscle, and surprisingly for thyroid gland. So this, I don't know why, that is something interesting, yeah, also, which potentially could be investigated. So here I would like to show actually what are the sample pages, because I think they are most indicative for this data set. So let's take liver example again. So I go to the sample table, then I click to the sample name which correspond to the liver. And now I see, let's wait a little bit, the picture is loading, yes. And so what I see on the top, I see sorted Z values for this sample. So I see the top 10 positive Z top 10 motifs with highest positive Z values, and also top 10 motifs with negative Z value. So basically here, from this, you immediately see that highest Z value, and it means highest activity in this sample, correspond to liver specific factors. So if we take some other data set which are well known, like brain or muscle, for example, we will see on the top transcription factors which are most significant for a given sample. So the same value, basically all values are presented in the table on underneath. So it contains a motif name, a corresponding Z value, and then what we've seen before, again, the links to the gene information, a corresponding logo. And from here, you can actually see, motifs with most negative or most positive Z value. So by the way, so this Z value, which is shown here, is not Z value, which is shown on the table on the main page. On the main page, we see averaged square Z values over all samples. And here actually is individual Z value for the corresponding sample. So Z value is activity divided by its error bar, so by standard deviation. Now let's move to the mean activities page. So as Eric already mentioned, mean activities are fitted differently. So this is not just activities which are summed and divided by number of samples. So they are fitted in a special way. And high mean activities usually represent motifs which targets are consistently high or consistently low expressed in the samples. Okay, first of all, it shows the top negative and top positive activities, which are sorted by absolute value. So, but in this case, it's not very informative, because on the top you see activities of some microRNAs, which are high, but also have very big standard deviation. So I think much more informative is the next plot, which shows the mean activities which are sorted by the Z values, by significance. And from here we can immediately see that so for our data set, so the most consistently high expressed targets belong to NRF1 motif. And NRF1 is known to regulate genes which are responsible for energy metabolism, some mitochondrial genes and so on. And these genes are known to be highly expressed in all conditions. In the same time, if you look at the bottom here, we see REST. And REST is known to be a repressor. And indeed, we see that for REST, REST targets are consistently low expressed across all samples in the dataset. Then basically you can access the same numbers for all motifs now in the table again. So it's sortable, it's searchable. So you can see the top mean activities, you can sort it by absolute value, you can sort it by Z value, and yeah, you can access additional information if necessary. All right. The next one, I would like now to go actually to return back to the mouse liver data set. And show quickly the gene search function and also the page which contain all promoters which are sorted by fraction of explained variants. So let's go first to this page, all promoters sorted by fraction of explained variants. So let's go here. So this is really large table. It contains all promoters which are expressed in this data set. So this is 27,000 entries in this table. And by default, they are sorted by fraction of explained variants. In addition, for every promoter, we also have a value of its mean expression over all samples and data set, the variance of expression over all samples. And here is a little annotation. So we have a promoter, and here we have a description of gene which correspond to this promoter. Now, if we either click on the promoter link or we click on the gene link, it's going to take us to a special page. And this page actually allows us to see how much different motifs contribute into the explaining observed expression of a given promoter. So on the top, we see a plot which demonstrate expression of a given promoter for a gene of interest. In this case, we have gene H2FX. It has only one promoter and here expression of this promoter. So here is the highest expression point. So here is the lowest expression point. So in case if there are multiple promoters per gene, we will see a multiple plots here. So you can see how expression of different promoters for a gene is changing. Now we have panel basically for every promoter, which contains first of all a plot of again of expression of this promoter, and in orange we have a predicted expression. So by default we turn off all predictions, so this line just corresponds to the mean expression of a promoter. So as I said, so on the right we have a table which contains all motifs which have a positive chi-square score. It means that these motifs do explain something of expression of this promoter. So here we have this chi-square score. The higher is chi-square score, the more significant is impact of the transcription factor to explaining the observed expression differences. Then for every motif, we also have corresponding psi count. So it basically sum of posterior probabilities of all transcription factor binding sites in this promoter for a given motif. So you see E to F2, so this motif has actually roughly saying two sites of high confidence in the, in this promoter. And here also the corresponding Z value overall significance of a given motif. Now, every motif have a, has a checkbox, and if we click it, we actually see a predicted expression which is based on expression of only this motif. So I can select this one and see only contribution from this motif. I can also combine it to see how expression changes, how predicted expression changes when I start to add a different motif. And yeah, in addition, I can actually turn all the all the motifs on, or I can turn it, it all off. So here you can observe actually how much every motif contribute into the explaining of observed expression of a given promoter. And now, if we go to this search gene, so this provide basically a quick way to access these pages for a certain gene of interest. So if before you can select some genes on the basis of fraction of explained variance, on the basis of mean expression, on the basis of variation of expression across the sample, here you can simply search a gene by name. So I had example, wait a second, I will find it. Yes, here, I think this is a good example. So this is a SIP2. So you see, you can also select something from the list, which drops down. So it supports auto-completion. So I, but I would like to search for a gene which is named SIP2C29. So it's here. Now it basically takes me again to the page we just seen before, but now here is information about expression of promoter for this gene. Again, for this gene, we have only a single promoter. Here is its expression. And now we can see which transcription factor contributes most to the explaining expression of this of this promoter. So in this case, you can see it just from chi-square score. So of course, when most of all contribute HNF for alpha. And so this is not surprising because it's known that this gene is regulated by this one. And then there is a bunch of other motifs which also contribute into the explaining of expression of this promoter. Okay, few words about ISMARA downloads before I move to the averaging and everything else. So, we provide, as I already said, downloads of activity table, delta table, regulatory interactions, and so on. And most of these tables are given in a simple text format. So these are tab separated values. So it looks something like this. So it could be either directly read by different analysis software, or it could be easily parsed by the scripts which we prepared for data analysis. So here is example of regulatory interaction file, which represent basically data which are given in this top targets table. So we have promoter name, we have chi-square score, we have name of the motif which regulates this promoter, and then we have actually some annotation of a given promoter. So these are transcript name, gene name, and so on. So also you can download the whole report archive, which contains almost everything which you've just seen so far. So it contains the main page, it contains all tables, all pictures, all motif pages, and so on. What is missing in the report which you download, so with this report you don't get pages per individual genes, so these are not stored some anywhere, so they are generated on the fly, so it's this functionality available only on the server. Also, you don't get a page with promoters sorted by fold, because this also generated on the server. And also, yeah, if you download report, so for offline browsing, you don't have interactive features like averaging functionality, which again works only on the store. Okay, now I would like actually talk about averaging. This scheme roughly represents what happened. So we select some groups of samples, and then inside these samples, then we average the activities. So it basically collapses into a single point, and then we observe a new profile of averaged activities. So it was applied to the Illumina body map, and actually for liver data set as well. So here is a comparison. So you see, in this case, we have two replicates for every sample, and after averaging, we have only one. For for Illumina body map, it's probably not so crucial because there is very good reproducibility between replicates. But in some data set, when you observe a certain noise between replicates just inside one sample, the averaging, for example, of replicates inside the sample could be quite crucial in order to obtain clear results. So I would like to show quickly how you select things when you need to do averaging. And for that, I'm going to use another data set which we have. So this is actually a microarray experiment about, if I remember correctly, mesenchymal transition of human cells. So here is the data set. Let's wait until it loads. Okay, and now, in order to average replicates, so we have two replicates per sample, so I just simply need to click perform sample averaging. So now, once I click perform sample averaging, I get a new menu appearing in this sample table. So you can specify again here email address. In case for your data, actually, your email address should be here shown by default. So it just takes the original email address you submitted with. But you can specify a new one if you like. And here you can specify also a project name. By default, this is old project name with average prefix added. You can also submit it anonymously if you like. Now, so we need actually to specify groups. So for that, we have here drop-down menus. And so what I'm going to do, so I have, in this case, these two samples. So this is a condition one in this case. So replicate one, replicate two. And now I can also select, so in this case, this is not, so that will be condition two. And that will be condition three, condition four. This will be condition three and condition four. Now, actually, I can rename this condition if you the way I like. So for example, sample one, and you see it's automatically changing in all corresponding fields, sample two. So if now I I run averaging. Sample four. If now I run averaging, so I will have how many? I will have four groups. It will calculate for me 4 points, which will correspond to the averaging between replicates. I could do it differently. So and actually specify that all these cells I would like to average actually to 1 point. So you see, I can do it like this. So in example, yeah, you see here. So in this case, yeah, I have two replicates for this point, and then all other which are underneath here will be merged into one group. So this way you can do very different contrast in different data set in order to obtain the contrast you would like to see between different conditions. And finally, in order to submit, so once I finished, I simply click submit data for averaging, and I'm taken to the same status page like when you submit ISMARA data. So also I would like to say now a few words about batch effect correction, which is also available here in advanced replicate effect option. So first couple slides about this. So what is the batch effect correction? So here is example. Let's say we have three samples again. And so in sample two, you see the difference between replicates is actually higher than the difference between samples if we average them. So, and if we plot it like this, it looks like noise data is not reproducible and so on. But if we plot this data differently, so it was done into different batches, so this is kind of real example. So if we plot it differently, every batch now is in different color. So you see actually that profile of expression changes is exactly the same. They are only shifted and rescaled relative to each other. And in order to remove such effects from the data, we applied a rather simple method. We just use standardization of the data. So what it means basically, it means that we recalculate activities by subtracting the mean inside the group and dividing it by the, subtracting the mean inside the batch and dividing by the standard error inside the batch. So we basically take our data, like shown here, apply this procedure, and we get basically shifted and rescaled profile, which is now quite easy to compare. And now if we average the data, so we average between replicates, we get basically the result which we expect. So before I go and show how you can select different options for this batch effect correction, I would like to say that we usually do not recommend to apply batch effect correction without clear understanding what you want to do, because batch effect correction does change the data. And if you start to apply it to everything, especially to the system which do not have batch effect, so you risk to get some results which could be wrongly interpreted. So also batch effect correction has some limitation. It requires that you have the same number of points in every batch. So as I said, so in order to run batch correction, you need to click these advanced options. And now, okay, let's change back. So it was condition two, that is condition three, condition four, and now we have two, three, four. So now I just say that the first replicates are produced in one experiment and second was produced in another experiment. So I have two batches, I suspect that there are some effect which should be corrected. And so first of all, I select like before the groups for averaging, and now I need to specify the batches. In this case, my batches will be first batch for all first replicates, so it will be like this. And now I select the batches for the second set of replicates. And now, so you see, here are corresponding selection of groups to average, and here corresponding selection of batches to normalize. And so basically now I just need to click submit, and yeah, it will take me to the page and run everything. All right, yes. Yeah, before I move on, I would like also to give example of averaging between different conditions. So if you go to example page, we have example results for GNF Atlas, which includes 79 tissues and cell line plus reference cancer cell lines. And so you can do a lot of these data sets, but what we try to do, we simply have applied averaging to see if there are any transcription factors which clearly separate cancer cells from non-cancer cells. So if you look at the data set itself, so you can see that it's quite noisy. But if we apply the averaging, it can provide it with quite nice results, which are summarized in this slide. So here are the top motifs, which we which have rather significant Z value after averaging. And you see the top motifs are basically left point in this case correspond to non-cancer cells, and the right correspond to the cancer cells. So you see basically that for example, IBX has high activity in cancer cells, and these genes, these transcription factors are known to be to have a high activity in cancer cells. There are a few more examples like this MYC-MYX or ZNF143. But we also have example of motifs with low activity of cancers, and it is known to be true. So for example, this VRNIP or RFX, which activity drops in cancer cells. So this is example how you can apply the averaging not only to the replicates, but also to a different condition. So at the end, I would like to mention alternative ways to upload data to the server. Sometimes user experience problems with uploading data over web interface. Most of the time, I have impression this is because of some technical problems in between, not really on user side, not really on our side, but on different filters, firewalls, and proxies, which are just in between of us and the user computer. So in order to provide a more robust way to upload the data, so we have developed a so-called upload client for Ismara. So this upload client is simply a Python script which you can run on any machine. Basically, it's cross-platform. But idea behind is behind this script is that you run it directly on machine which stores your data. So I'm not sure how it happens in other places, but in our case, for example, we have a big Linux cluster, and this Linux cluster has direct connection to the storage system. So this data is directly available. And then on this Linux cluster, I can simply run my uploader from terminal in background, and this uploader will just run in background and upload my data to the Ismara server. So Here is a summary how it works. So it's simple program with a few parameters to specify. It provides basically exactly the same functionality like web interface. So you can specify email, project, data type, genome. Select if you want to run it with Mirna or not. And the only difference, you need to provide a file list. It's just text file which contains paths to the files to upload, one path per line. So you call this script, you provide that file list, you hit enter, and yeah, then it runs fine. The only thing to watch out is that to make sure that you properly run it in the terminal, and this script is not terminated once your session is over or broken. So for that, you can use either nohub command or screen or tmux utilities. Okay, so here example of a file which contains paths. And finally, also to mention the Ismara client. So Ismara client is a standalone application which was developed to run on Linux and Mac machines. And these are available also from the, I think, how to download data section on Ismara web server. So what is special about this program? This program actually runs some pre-processing steps on your local machine. So it takes your data, it runs pre-processing steps, it obtains much smaller summary table, and this summary table sent to Ismara server instead of all your big FASQ or BAM files. So this client basically supports almost everything like a web interface. With only limitation, it doesn't support FASQ processing, but it can process the bed, BAM, and cell files. It provides some history information about which jobs you have run, and also access to the to links to the results which you have. All right, so here's some information about these things. And okay, this is not relevant. And last minute, I would like also to mention expert mode. So expert mode allows you basically to run Ismara on anything you like. So you need to supply here the table which contains expression or some other signal, for example, chipsex signal for a set of genomic features. So originally Ismara used promoters. And then you need also to supply a signed count table. So this table basically summarizes how many transcription factor binding sites you have for every genomic feature. And once you supply both of these tables, you can actually run Ismara on anything. So for people who want to run some unsupported organisms, so I suggest that you can contact me, and I can give you some direction how you can test your data in expert mode. So we've seen some successful examples, some people running, for example, Ismara analysis for salmon genome. Of course, you need to invest some time in this, but it's doable. Okay, I think I will finish now to be in time. And now, you are free to ask questions.